think I found out the day before the game that Ian was going to be there, and that's when I probably was like, wow, this is a pretty big thing. I actually used to say that I didn't play football. At the time, I was probably a bit embarrassed to say that because I was the only girl.
Luis Suarez left a mark on you, didn't he?
I think the headline was Luis Suarez, two-footed Liverpool women's player, and I think I was too quick for him on the rondos. I think anyone who's been a part of Liverpool, like, you'll know it's such a unique feeling. And obviously, I was away, I was at other clubs, but I think coming back to it, you realise what you've missed. But being a fan of the club and caring so much, it definitely kind of motivates me to want to bring success back here.
Welcome, Gem.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Everyone says that.
It really is.
To say that now. Like,
yeah, but it's always a good
media
start,
training.
Yeah, it's a good start. Good to see you anyway.
Yeah, great to see you. Record breaker. The one thing I thought when I saw the video of that was, how good's this going to be to show to everybody? Everybody you loved was there.
Mm-hmm.
Ian Callaghan, the record holder for the men as well.
Yeah, I mean, it probably still hasn't really sunk in. I think I found out the day before the game that Ian was going to be there, and that's when I probably was like, wow, this is a pretty big thing. So for him to be there and kind of show his support and actually present and have my whole family there, I actually got emotional at the moment. But I think for me it was more having my family there, because I would never have obviously got to where I am without them. So having them there and actually having them made a fuss of, I think it really made it special.
You could tell. I often think with stuff like this, you know, when you do presentations before the game, how quickly you can get back into the zone again. But, you know, your mum doesn't get to many games.
Mm-hmm.
It was a big thing because of your dad watching you and taking you to every game you've ever played in your life.
Yeah.
It's quite a seismic day for you, that, isn't it?
Yeah, it was. I think I was saying to my dad, I was like, he's had probably more appearances than me in terms of he's been at every single game. So, yeah, especially having my mum there. But you're right, it was emotional. But, you know, trying to go back in the dressing room straight away and be like, I didn't want anything to affect me, because it was a big game for us. And I had to remember, just go out, clear head, and thankfully I managed to score as well. So it was a real special day. We got clean sheet, 4 goals. I couldn't have really wished for it to go any better.
Typical defender, clean sheets.
It's important, clean sheets, you know that.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So if we go back where it all started, back home in Leeds, a lot of your friends play football, or were you the one who stood out?
No, I was probably the only girl. I played when I was younger, just kind of kicking around. I've got 4 older brothers and an older sister. None of them played. Not really a sporting family. It was probably when I went into primary school, started playing with the boys. And that was every kind of lunch break, playing in the playground. In primary school, I played for the boys' team and the girls' team. And there was girls that played in primary school. I was lucky with my PE teacher that I had. And I'm actually still in contact with him now, because I think for me going through, there weren't that many people that encouraged girls playing football, but he was definitely a big part in that in primary school. So it was mainly then, once you leave primary school, I had to stop playing with the boys, and no girl wanted to play in high school. So outside of that, I was at Leeds Centre of Excellence.
Was that a little bit frustrating, was it, that there wasn't as many women playing and you kind of had to look to find a club or to find a game?
Yeah, I think I remember going with my dad to look at high schools when we went to the PE section, of course. And we asked, like, do you have a girls' football team? And they were like, no. And I said, would you start one? And they said, you know, there was a lot of things about staff that didn't want to do it, or the timing, the commitments of staff. And I actually remember trying to go around and getting a list of girls together that I knew from primary school and also that I'd made friends with, and was like, does anyone want to start a football team? But it didn't really materialise, because, again, there was no one that was willing to kind of take it on. But for me, I was lucky. I was at the Centre of Excellence at Leeds. So I think having that, and obviously my supportive parents, they took me every single training I was at. It was Thorpe Arch, the training ground. So I was out every night of the week training with my club and keeping that going. And it wasn't, I'd say, probably until I think I was about 13 and I got my first international camp letter to school. Before that, they were very reluctant for me to leave lessons early if I had a game in the evening. And it wasn't until this letter comes through from the FA that, you know, the teacher's going, oh, you need a week off, because the timings were different with the camp. sure, you can have the week off. And I was thinking, hang on a minute, like, I wanted half an hour off to go to play a game, and now just because of England have come in, you're going to let me have a week. So that was probably my first experience of being exposed to people that, you know, they're only there when the success comes. So I picked up that quite early, and I was still very aware of that. And the more I've kind of gotten older, you realise there's a lot of people like that.
What about your non-football friends in school? Was it always something you were proud of? It's obviously a pride thing now for girls playing football because of how high profile the game is, but it might have been a little bit different when you were younger.
Yeah, I mean, I'm actually still close to a couple of friends from school who actually have no idea about football. And for me, it's good and it's nice to go back to them because it completely takes me out of that environment. Honestly, a lot of my friends growing up were a lot of boys because I had a lot more in common with them. I didn't really care what I looked like. I just wanted to go out in the playground and play football. I'd probably say it changed a little bit the more I got into high school. I actually used to say that I didn't play football. You know, if people would come up to me and ask me, oh, do you play football? I would actually say no, because at the time I was probably a bit embarrassed to say that because I was the only girl. So I just wanted to, you know, get my head down and kind of carry on about my day. But I think now I look back, and if someone says to me, like, oh, what do you do? I'm very proud to say that, you know, I play football and I have done for however many years. But that's probably one thing, looking back, I wish I'd had more confidence to say, like, yeah, I do. But I think the nature of how it was, me being a girl going into the high school and boys coming up to you, oh, you're the footballer, I was quite shy in actually admitting that.
So as a young girl, I mean, it's a sport you're playing. So when did you realise that this could actually go further?
Probably the moments when I was younger was when my school teacher, they got me into the Leeds Centre of Excellence, which was the step up outside of club.
How old were you then?
I was actually 9, but they didn't have an under 10, so I was playing in the under 12s. And we used to have a tournament at Warwick every year. And that was when we played the likes of Arsenal, Chelsea. And that was for me the first time, because at the club at Leeds, you only played local teams. So when we went on this one day a year to the Warwick tournament, it was playing Arsenal. And I actually started in goal as a 9-year-old in the under-12s. Yeah. So that was probably a moment where I was like, wow, this is actually pretty cool. Like, I'm playing against the big teams. And then again, when I got the call up for my first under-15s international camp, I was 13. That was, again, another kind of stepping stone. Was like, okay, this is really something that I can do. But it didn't really stop how I thought day to day. It probably just motivated me even more. But I'd probably say my hardest moment was actually my first year of under-16s at club level. I was made to retrial to get into the team the following year. You know, I've learned over the years that all managers have opinions as well. And that was their decision at the time. They didn't want to re-sign me. I had to retrial. I was one of the only players at Leeds going away on international. Yeah, I was made to retrial for the under-16s. So that was probably a moment where I was like, okay, it's either going to happen or it's not. And that was probably one where I thought, right, I've got to get my head down here. Obviously retrialed, I got back into the team. And then the following year, at the end of that, I was 16. And then that's when you go to senior football. And I remember turning up to trial for the reserves team. with all my teammates from the year before, and the manager at Leeds was there, and he came up to me, he said, what are you doing here? You're coming to the first team tomorrow. So I was like, oh, I was just trialing out for the reserves or the development team. He said, no, you're coming to the first team tomorrow. So that was, again, another step. I was 16, and I was then gone from being retried in the year before to then being the youngest in the first team. So I had a lot of probably experiences in those couple of years, probably testing in terms of my motivation and how much did I really want to do it. So yeah, I probably did learn a lot when I was quite young.
How difficult was it for your mum and dad then when all of a sudden it was relocating, there was teams interested in you, it was going to mean moving to London? There wasn't, you know, lavish riches involved in the game then.
No, I mean, Leeds was all I'd ever known. So when I was 16, England used to have a scholarship programme at Loughborough, and there was about 20 players each year that got offered the scholarship, and you had to go for an interview process. And automatically, my mum was a bit reluctant for me to move out at 16. But anyway, we went through the process. I ended up getting selected to go in. So at 16, I'm eventually moving out. I should go to live in a children's home because I was under 18. So I would train Monday to Friday at Loughborough, and I mean, I was lucky there because I was 16 and it was Kaz Carney, Jill Scott. They were all senior internationals at the time. So they really kind of took me under the wing. I was training with senior internationals at the time. And that was definitely an experience, Monday to Friday, training, doing college. I was up doing 7 o'clock gym sessions, then college through the day, straight back to the pitch, and then trying to find time to actually do my studying in the evening that first year, as well as being away on international. Mm. That was probably one of the hardest years. And then after 3 years there, that was the final year because the Super League was coming in. At the time, this was a lot had been said about the league's going to change, it's going to become more professional. And this was probably the first moment that it was like, actually, the Super League's coming in. It's going to be a semi-professional league with a view to go full-time. And obviously, I was still at Leeds and they'd submitted an application to go into the Super League. And that was great. I was going to come home, do my university at Leeds, have it all paid for, everything, because it was a partner. I remember I think it was December time. We come in after a game on a Sunday and we get told basically the bid for us to be in the Super League has been taken away because the university have pulled out the backing. But the problem was it was after the deadline, so we couldn't find someone else to refund it. So basically, if you want to play in the top league, you're going to have to leave. I remember just crying in the change room because I'd grown up through Leeds. That was all I ever knew. I was going to move back home, do university and, you know, be a footballer because that's all I wanted to do. And then everybody left that team because everyone was a senior international or youth international, had options because they'd been playing every single week. We played through the winter and the new league went to a summer league. So I decided to stay at Leeds to get game time because I didn't have that experience. So in that time period, I was hoping I would have options. The Christmas period came and I was kind of getting to the point where I had to decide if I'm going to join a Super League team. I need to decide in this next week. Funnily enough, in the meantime, I was actually looking at Liverpool. That was one of my options. And I had another two or three clubs came in that same week. So I'm sat with my mum and dad, I'm like looking at the options, and I ended up going and signing for Chelsea, which logistically, when I'm studying at Leeds, was 215 miles to training and 215 miles back. I remember sat with my mum and dad and I was thinking in my head, Chelsea is the one that I want to go to because it's the best thing for me. But I didn't know how I was going to do it. So I was reluctant to actually say where I wanted to go. And it was my dad that said, well, there's no brainer, it's Chelsea. Well, and I was like, that's too far, you know, it's just not going to work. And he said, no, we'll make it work. So for me, that was, you know, it was an unbelievable thing that they showed that for me. So I was still studying. Dad would pick me up from uni. So I'd do my lectures in the morning and I would train a Tuesday, Thursday and play on a weekend. So yeah, I think in 6 months we racked up 30,000 miles on the car. And, you know, the contract at the time didn't even cover that. But I mean, luckily while I was in the car driving, obviously on the way to training one night, I actually got my first call up for England. I got the phone call. So they were probably two real pivotal moments that, you know, I'm doing all this, but actually it was the best decision for me at the time. Don't get me wrong, it was probably one of the hardest periods in terms of managing my work, my studying, because it was still important to me to get that done. And then obviously trying to play football and make a career too. So I did that for 2 years.
It's a massive commitment and desire to want to make it, isn't it? So what changes now you're at Chelsea? I mean, obviously better teammates, better facilities, better coaching. Did you sort of feel this is going in the right direction now?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I was playing with internationals every day. I was playing against internationals. So that was the first time for me that I was like, this is me cementing myself in senior football and getting regular football. And I did that for 2 years and then I could see it was progressing, but I wasn't necessarily I was doing a lot of training on my own as well because I was only doing two sessions a week with the team, which is what it was. Some weeks I would only do one session because I had university commitments and obviously the travel. But I would turn up and play every minute on a game day. So for me, I didn't want to be the player that just turned up and played and didn't train. So I think towards, as I was coming into my final year of university, I was probably getting to the point where I've got a big year for studying, but also the game's growing. I need to be on the football more. You know, you can run as much as you want, but it's not the same as football. So that was when I made the decision to come to Liverpool. And for me, it was probably perfect timing in terms of my career and my education. But also, it was the beginning of obviously a huge project, what turned out to be an extremely successful move.
But it was an incredible successful time.
Oh, it was honestly some of the best days I've had. When the team got together, it was players that were either unhappy at their teams, they were young players, or we were there to prove a point. And I think when you put a team together, you don't really expect players to gel so quick. But I think the people that we brought in, everyone had the right motivation, and the respect in that group was unbelievable for each other, and we were all there to win. And I think it showed in the performances, it showed in how we came in every day. We would be demanding of each other, but we also knew that we needed each other to perform, to be successful. And I think I definitely learned a huge amount. And like I say, it goes back to bringing culture in from other countries. I think that was a huge part of our success and how we blended together, because, you know, I think we signed 13 or 14 players, and then we went and won the league in that season when no one outside of it expected us to do it. We had such a belief within, so it was definitely such a special time.
And you were made captain as well, a very young captain. Farah Williams, I think probably still a record. Yeah. English cap holder. Lucy Bronze, who was a fantastic player then, went on to unbelievable things in her career. And there's young Gemma Bonner, who's got the armband.
Yeah, I mean, when I was actually first asked, I actually said no. Because, like you say, I was just young me, just kind of coming in. One, excited about the project, excited about being at Liverpool, because I'd always wanted to play for Liverpool. And I looked up to so many players on that team. And when he first asked me, I was like, no, there's much more, you know, more probably equipped players to be captain than me. I don't think I'm ready for it. I'm not the best person for it. And he said, you know, just have a think about it and we'll put you at for pre-season and let's see how you go. So I was a bit like taken aback, shocked by it. And again, speaking to my family, I think one of the moments was, obviously, I've done actually a lot with Kevin Sinfield lately, and he's always been someone that I've always respected. And my dad actually said to me at the time, you know, he was made captain when he was 21. If, you know, you respect him so much, you look at his career, there's no reason why you can't grow into the role. And that was probably another moment for me that I thought, you know, why not? I think I'm mature enough. And again, I'm lucky the people that we had. I had people like Farah, Amanda Da Costa within the team that everyone led in different ways. So it wasn't, I didn't just feel a responsibility on me. I could lean on them. So I definitely grew into the role. I was by no means the perfect captain, but I've never been a shouter. I always try and lead by what I do, and that's not really changed throughout the years. So I did actually say no in the first instance. But yeah, I was incredibly grateful for the team that we had, because, you know, it could have been quite the opposite for a 21-year-old captain coming into a team of experienced players. But for me, the group that we had, it really allowed me to kind of be myself and be comfortable in who I was.
You speak to these lads about winning titles and winning trophies. They always say that retaining a trophy is better than winning it in the first place. You go along with that as well, having done it back to back?
Yeah, I think I'd agree with that. I think the first one was special, but the second one, I still can't believe we did it on this day now, because we started the day in third position. We needed, I think, 3 or 4 results to go our way, and we won it on goal difference. And again, no one expected. I think the trophy was in Manchester. We actually had to wait at the end of the game. We were watching. It was one of the first games that was actually on BT, and actually, you know, you had the multi-game that you could see what was going on, and I think we were watching it on some fan's phone in the crowd to what was happening in the other games. There was penalty saves, there was worldy goals, and we end up winning it.
Crazy, isn't it? Was the party better second time around?
No, we had Champions League. We actually played Champions League that week. So it was, you didn't really have time to celebrate. And it was the same the first time around. We had always something. I think we played on that Thursday. So I think we actually went to Nando's and celebrated because it was the closest restaurant.
I mean, the majority of clubs are in England, but you had one spell in America. And I just always get the feeling that that's the flag bearer of women's football. So what was that experience like?
I left Liverpool wanting to challenge myself because I found myself quite comfortable here. And in my career, I still wanted to win. There was the cup competitions that we never could win here. And I needed another challenge. I think obviously changing environments. So I went to City, completely different challenge, really pushed me out of my comfort zone. I won the cups that I'd always wanted to do. And then again, I think it was completely unexpected, but until those conversations happen, again, I didn't realise I'd probably got a little bit more comfortable. I'd been in the league for 15 years against the same players every single week. And I thought, if I don't do it now, when am I ever going to do it? And the chance to play against, again, a different league, completely different style of play. I went pretty much into the unknown. I didn't know any of my teammates, didn't know anyone. I was just thought, you know what? I want to challenge myself. I want to push myself again. Don't get me wrong, it was definitely hard. There was a lot of stuff that happened off the pitch as well, which mentally it was challenging. In terms of, you know, my manager got sacked 2 months after being there. So I was lucky again with the teammates that I had. I definitely made friends pretty quickly, but the league itself was so transitional, which obviously in England, you don't really get as many transition moments, but I played against some of the best strikers in the world. And I think for me, the big thing was the league was so competitive. Probably in Europe, you can probably expect how the game's going to go in terms of teams are going to sit in a block or you're going to have a lot of possession. There's probably one or two threats that you need to nullify from the opposition. But I think in America, it's all go. There's no predicting of how the game's going to go. So for me as a defender, I had to be switched on from minute one to 90 because if you switched off, there was a transition moment and you'd be punished. So that was probably the first time in my career, being a little bit older, where I've really kind of felt physically, emotionally, and technically, tactically, you had to figure things out because how they play over there is very different to here.
They often say that you don't realise how good life is as a Liverpool player until you leave. What about coming back then? So you joined the club in the first place, somebody who had posters of all these Liverpool players on their wall, must have been some feeling. When you eventually come back, is that even, you know, greater as a celebration because you realise what you'd had before?
Yeah, I think you probably missed a feeling. I think anyone who's been a part of Liverpool, like, you'll know it's such a unique feeling and you don't really understand that feeling of being part of the family unless you're actually here. I was incredibly lucky that when I was away, the fans were unbelievable with me and always showed me the support. So I think coming back was special, but you know, it also makes me want to be more successful, especially with the club when you've got such an attachment to it. For me, I think, you know, anything I do 100%. But being a fan of the club and caring so much, it definitely kind of motivates me to want to bring success back here.
How did that all come about? The phone call, the interest? Is there any stories you can tell us about that?
Yeah, I think when I finished the season in America, this was probably the first time in my career that I could just have time off and really kind of think about what I wanted to do and where I wanted to go. I came back home. I was working the TV games with Pete and it was quite a strange situation because I knew Liverpool had interest, but I was almost watching the games, working the games, but also trying to think in my head, can I see myself playing in this team? Because, you know, I said before, I didn't want it to be an emotional decision. I wanted to make sure the fit was right for me as a player. And I think the more games I watched, obviously the team had built good foundation in terms of being promoted back up that first year. And yeah, it was definitely a strange situation watching and trying to kind of envision myself within that team. But I was actually at a wedding the day that I agreed to sign. And it was almost like, wow, I can't believe I'm actually back. I think I remember when I left, it was honestly one of the hardest things. And I knew that one day I would have loved to come back, but I didn't know if that was going to be possible, if or when it was going to happen. And I remember it actually happening and thinking, wow, I'm actually coming back. Like, this actually feels the right thing to do. I did have other options at the time, but I think for me, I've always seems to probably get the best out of myself when I care about something and I really invest myself. And I had to make sure that it was the right decision to make sure that I could fully throw myself into it. And then I think when I obviously told my family the news, it was just before Christmas. And, you know, obviously the announcement video was the letter that I wrote to Santa when I was 6 or 7 years old, asking for a Liverpool kit for Christmas. So I actually got my niece a Liverpool kit for Christmas, and that was how I told my family that, just on Christmas Eve, you know, I didn't tell them until it was announced, till it was finally done. That was my decision, and they were all extremely happy. And for me, I was, I couldn't wait to get started coming in January.
The manager, Matt Baird, who's a person you know really well, was he a big part of you making that decision?
Obviously, I'd worked under him previously. I knew what he was about, and I think the way he kind of came into the team, obviously they were in the Championship, and he organises the teams well, and I knew that obviously being a newly promoted team into the league, it was the priority was to stay up last season. So I knew going into it how he worked, we would be hard to beat, and I think for me, I needed to see progression, and he had ambitions, he wants to win, and he also wanted to improve the squad, and that also aligned with me. I didn't want to just come in and be comfortable and just come back because I knew I could. I care about Liverpool. I want to make them successful. And I feel like since I left to coming back, I hope I've definitely improved as a player with my experiences and as a person. And I've tried to bring that experience. It was definitely a different situation when I came back in terms of I've probably been used to winning a lot of the games, and when you're coming into a newly promoted team, not every game is going to be plain sailing. So again, mentally it was a challenge for me, as well as learning. As much as I was coming back, it was a completely different team, different environment. So I had to get up to speed quite quick, which probably helped me, to be honest, in terms of, you know, everyone says don't go back to your club, but for me it was completely different. New teammates, and you know, I think there was only maybe one or two players that I'd played with before, so it didn't necessarily feel like I was coming back in that sense. So yeah, I tried to be me in that situation, and I think very quickly our first game was won against United, and it was probably one that I'll quickly put to bed just after that. And that was probably when I felt, you know, this is the time we've really got to get our heads down and I had to try and do my best and bring out what I could for myself to help and contribute to the team.
There's another fascinating part of your life story in that you've been with a professional athlete for a long time. You lived together, Willie Iser, who's a very successful rugby league player in his own right. How does that dynamic work when your results might be completely different from one weekend to the next?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I think we're pretty lucky. I think being in our environment, you'll know it's quite a unique lifestyle that you can't predict schedules. They could change at 10 o'clock at night for the next day. So we're very understanding of each other. We also accept that our careers come first, and we've been incredibly supportive of each other. I think he was almost as shocked as I was when the transfer stuff was done over Zoom. And I think when I shut the laptop, I said, I want to go. I think he was almost as shocked as I was, but he said, look, if that's what you want to do, then go and do it. Obviously, he's not from England, so he's always experienced playing internationally and learning new culture. And he's always probably encouraged me to go and outside and challenge myself. So he was incredibly supportive throughout that stage of moving away. But obviously now, being back home, we try and push and support each other. We do have a thing where we don't give each other sympathy because we realise we're in a blessed situation with the lives that we have. We're lucky we're doing something we love every single day. But yeah, we try and enjoy the time that we do get off together, which is very few and far between at the moment. But, you know, we say our careers don't last forever. So we try and push each other to be the best we can be.
He supports you in all of your games. I can remember walking away from Anfield where you'd just been beaten in the Merseyside Derby. He just won the grand final. the day before, maybe 24 hours before, and it was almost like he felt guilty about being upbeat about it because he knew that you were a bit down about what had happened an hour before at the game.
Yeah, I mean, that was a weekend where I think before it was, they'd obviously won the semi-final the weekend before, and it was, he's going to be playing at Old Trafford on Saturday and we had the derby at Anfield on Sunday. So as weekends get, the games probably don't get much bigger in our household. I mean, I was lucky enough that I could actually be there on the Saturday night and support him. But yeah, definitely it was an extreme high for him. And for me, I was devastated after that derby loss. For me, we look at it at the point was, you know, again, we're grateful for what we do. I think actually back in 2016, when they won the grand final then, I was actually at the Old Trafford again the Saturday night, and we actually played Doncaster Bells away on the Sunday. And so he's turned up. And back then there was probably about 100 people in the crowd. And on the Sunday afternoon, he sat there thinking, what am I doing here? But yeah, I mean, it shows the highs and lows. For us, we support each other. And for me, I try and, you know, we do try and not bring it home, because obviously we respect the other people and that we're both going to have different emotions. And I think we allow ourselves the day to be disappointed, because naturally you're going to be. But I think at the same time, you can't be disappointed for too long. If you dwell on it, it's going to keep on affecting you. So we also very good at letting each other have the time, but making sure that once it hits midnight or the next day, you know, we're ready to go again. We can't be feeling sorry for ourselves.
You mentioned before you've been at it for a long time, played at the top level for more than 15 years. Mm-hmm. And now you're back at Liverpool. I mean, you must see a lot of changes now being back with Melbourne and everything else.
So when I left, we'd just been training at Edge Hill and we were back at Widnes on the turf pitch. And the club went through a lot of criticism from the outside. I think obviously Liverpool being such a big club, anything that they can probably target, they did. And the women's team was definitely one that was probably hit on the most in terms of how they looked after the players, the training facilities. And for me, I was one of the longest serving players at the time, obviously the captain, and I really cared about the club. So it was a hard situation. But again, I also knew I had my own career. And don't get me wrong, there were things that definitely could have been a lot better. But for me, coming back, I definitely think the kind of mindset has changed in terms of, you know, what we have now is unbelievable. And I think coming back, I knew that the training facility was one thing that the club really, it was high on their priority. And I think obviously being relegated into the Championship, they probably almost had to start from scratch and again work hard to change people's perceptions of the club, in terms of no players were attracted to Liverpool. Whereas now I think, you know, now players see that we're at Melwood, we're having a successful season, then automatically it attracts players. So for me, knowing that coming back, obviously emotionally I had the attachment, but I was very aware I didn't want to make an emotional decision, because I wanted to know that my value was going to be added to the team. So I think knowing that, you know, the club was moving in the right direction, obviously Melwood is a huge plus for just me as a player in terms of coming in, the pitches, the recovery, the nutrition. I think the whole part, we're in an environment now with no excuses, which we've probably never really can say we've had before. So I think for me that also attracts the players, which is a big part. Like, I want to be successful, I want to win every game that I play in, and having that kind of whole club package attraction, I think definitely in maybe a few years we'll definitely really see the fruition of the effects of Melwood. But I think honestly we're starting to see them already now.
It's interesting that, so it's almost that because you have this wonderful facility now and all these things at your fingertips, they expect even more of you. This is not a place now where we'll accept you not beating the top teams anymore.
Completely. I think I've always felt, you know, you're at Liverpool, you're expected to win. And I've always had that before. And for me, I've always been, you know, I'm probably a bit old school in the sense that, you know, you could be out on the field, out on the park, but as long as you've got 10 teammates behind you that are willing to do everything, then what more do you need, you know, to win a game? Because for me, I've always prided myself on hard work, and I think everyone knows that, you know, if your team doesn't work hard, then you're not going to win the game. Whereas you have a team of 11 players that are willing to have each other's backs, you can go so far with that. And I think having the whole kind of the pressure of being at Liverpool, now being at Melwood, for me, I love it because I want to be winning. I enjoy winning. And for me, the pressure, I enjoy, because it means you care about the club. You want to be successful. And I think for me, it drives me every day. I think it's the same on the women's team. We have to build something that's sustainable.
Had James Milner on, Andrew Robertson talking about fines. You know, you're on young players if they're not there on time. How does it work in your dressing room?
I am one of the fine people. Yeah, it's funny you should say that, actually, because, you know, the Christmas party's coming up, so the elves are out trying to get the fine money in. But, you know, I'd say for us, we're probably still learning our culture. We've had a lot of players coming in. We've got young players. So it's almost trying to get them up to speed as quick as possible. For me, it was almost a difficult position because I rejoined partway through a season. Yeah. And when you're a player coming in midway through the season, you kind of just have to get up to scratch as quick as you can. But I am part of the fines committee this year. So, yeah, there's been a few unhappy people this year.
What's the rate? Come on, because we heard the quite expensive phone goes off. Oh, 500 quid, it's obviously not that. But how harsh are you on certain rules?
I mean, there's a fine committee and I think there's four or five of us on it. There's some that are, you know, we're wanting to fine every single thing we see. And there's some that are quite generous. So we kind of balance each other. But for us, we're quite lenient.
What are you big on, though? What are the no-nos?
Late to meetings, leaving kit left around. Late seems to be quite high on. The funny thing is, the other day, there's a few of the girls that had been hit for being fined, and we just stuck the fine list up on the changing room door. So Friday or Saturday, when everyone was back from international break, they go into the changing room, that's the first thing they see. So they took a picture of it to look through it, and they're sat in the changing rooms complaining about these fines that they'd got hit. Anyway, they look at the time, it's 10:31. The meeting started at 10:30. They come running through the door and everyone was ready for them. But, you know, I think it's a good laugh for us all, but I think everyone knows late is the biggest thing. But we do hit people for late. There's no excuses for that for me.
You're always on time, Jan. No problem.
Absolutely,
there.
We try our best.
I just want to ask you another bit about Melwood, because I can remember the time when Brendan Rodgers was in charge. It was a big day there. You know, the women were going to come and train with the fellas. They were going to get a team group done. Mm-hmm. Everything else. As a young Liverpool fan, that must have been an unbelievable day for you.
Yeah, it was. I mean, we actually did rondos as well. So we actually got out on the pitch with them and trained, and the boys were great with us. I was looking at pictures with Lawsie the other day of the day when we came in and had the breakfast and kind of mixed with them. And for me, my experiences of being around them have always been great. They've always been so welcoming. So it was a little strange first time walking back into Melwood. After so many years of being away, I'd only really been there for situations like that or doing my rehab. So to actually walk back through the doors and being like, this is where I'm going to be every single day, not kind of just coming in, doing my rehab and leaving. I'm getting used to it now, let's say.
Luis Suarez left the mark on you, didn't he?
Yeah, I did. No, we were in the rondos and, you know, a lot was said. I think the headline was Luis Suarez, two-footed Liverpool women's player, and he didn't touch me. I think I was too quick for him on the rondos. But for us, we loved it. You know, we just want them to act as they would, and we would be the same to them. So I think it was obviously the respect thing, their playing, how they would train, we're training how we would. But yeah, it was definitely a day I won't be forgetting.
Do you think there's more to come from the women's game? I mean, it's made massive progress over the last 4 or 5 years. Do you think there's more to come?
Definitely. I think for us now, it's not just the first team at the women's. I think you're seeing we've got the academy now at Melwood. And for the young girls now, they've probably never really had access to the training facilities, actually a home that we can now call home and a training base. And they've probably not been able to see a vision or a pathway to the first team because there's not been something there. Whereas now they come through at Melwood, they're studying at the same time as they're training. I think our academy program is probably now one of the best in the country. And for me, it's not just about now, but there's so many young girls that come to our game that now we're actually getting a structure in place and a pathway so that in maybe 10 years time that, you know, it's not just a short term success for us, that we're actually building for the future. Because I think you see it obviously in the men's game, the academy players coming through, that's so many years behind them of hard work. And in the women's game, it's quite new to that. So I think having both the academy on the first team at Melwood, calling that home, then I think it's only going to get stronger. And, you know, we're seeing the women's game. I think Arsenal had another record crowd. So it's about, for us, building it, but also being sustainable too. Because, you know, there's still, I would say, a big gap in terms of the top. And I think realistically, last year, Reading got relegated from the league and then all of a sudden turned part-time. So the realistic things are still there. It's by no means, you know, every single team are flying high, but I think Liverpool traditionally have always been quite realistic in how they do stuff.
There's big changes coming in the future for the women's game. What impact do you think it will have coming away from an FA-run organisation?
I think it's big. There's always growth in the game. And I think for the women's game, we want to keep on pushing. And I think coming away from that, it almost pushes clubs to keep on building and keep on investing. And I think we've seen it year on year. I think we were the first club to do it back in 2013 and go full time. And it seemed every year after that, other clubs look at it and go, if Liverpool have done it, why can't we? And I think that barrier is constantly being pushed every single year. And I think for me, Chelsea at the moment, how they're going about, the way that they do things, the squad that they've managed to build, and they're competing on every single front. And I think they're really setting the benchmark for not just in England, but I think in Europe. And when you've got teams at the top that are pushing, and then you change, you kind of come away from the FA, you've got clubs that are going to want to be ambitious. But as for me, like I said before, the biggest thing is making sure that the league is sustainable, because the last thing we want is to have six teams that are competitive and then there be a big drop off. And I think we're doing so well in terms of having the championship in the league below that, you know, there's more and more teams in that league that are being full time. It's making sure we grow the game as a whole and not just kind of create a top four and a bottom kind of the rest.
What does the future look like, Gem? Have you thought about it? And does the future almost pan out a little bit differently now than maybe in your mind 2 years ago? That there seems to be so much on the agenda for you, whether it's coaching, whether it's TV, whether it's something completely outside of football.
Yeah, I mean, for now, obviously I didn't necessarily think that I would be back at Liverpool, but now I'm here. I'm loving being back, and playing-wise, this is the best I've felt in terms of my body. And, you know, everyone says as you get older, you should probably feel worse. This is the best I've actually felt. I've overcome a few niggles that I've had for a long time. So I'd love to carry on playing as long as I can, obviously. And then I think post-career, there's obviously I've done the media work. But for me, I think there's still a lot of probably scope in the women's game for actually creating a role and being involved in the football side. And actually, there's not necessarily sporting directors in the women's game and the philosophy and the identity of the club. So I'd love to stay involved on the football side, but it's still quite new in the women's game. So something along those lines, but definitely staying in the game, and I'd love to stay and be a part of Liverpool.
We like to put you through the ringer before we finish. Some quickfire questions. Superstitions. Pre-match rituals. Are you part of that?
No, that all went out the window in America.
Because
you'd have storm delays and everything. So you'd go out to warm up. It did used to be right before left, but after America, whatever's going to happen, happens.
First or second? First WSL title or the second? Which one would you pick? You can only take one with you.
I'm going to say second.
Yeah, doing it again. Is there one aspect of being a professional that you find tough? Is there a toughest part of being a footballer?
Losing.
You or Willie, the worst loser?
He'd say him, but I'd say me.
Must be a miserable house, that one. It's a double whammy. If you were going through a tough time on the pitch, which teammate would you turn to first to confide in off it?
This is going to sound really bizarre, but probably Fuka. I feel like we're on the same level. We have a lot of similar thoughts, and she's probably the calm head in the team. And in those situations, I just need concise thoughts, and she doesn't speak much English, so it's just probably going to help.
Yeah. I know what you're talking about. She's some player, by the way.
Yeah, isn't she? Unbelievable.
And three former teammates. This is horrible, this. Farah Williams, Lucy Bronze, Tash Dowie. Start one, sub one, sell one. Be careful.
I'd have to start Farah. I'd sub Lucy. And I'm going to sell Tash because she's probably got the most money with the goal scorers.
We'll have
She'll
to leave
love that.
That. Yeah, we'll have to leave that ember in. Could lose a friend there. Gemma, it's been fascinating to catch up. I learned loads about you that we didn't know. And I know Jan enjoyed it as well. A completely different aspect on the women's game and the future as well.
No, it's honestly been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for having me.